Hey, we're over here at Murray Machine with former British European champion, world title challenger, John Murray. John, how's it going, mate?
All right, mate, yeah.
It's good to see you. It's a nice gym.
Yeah, it's a nice gym, yeah. Building up bit by bit, busy in here. Working hard every day, long days. I start at 6 in the morning most days and finish at 8 o'clock at night, but I'm enjoying it. It's what I do for a living and it's what I've always done, so I'm looking up to be doing something that I love for a living, which is good, and I enjoy it. Yeah. It's decent.
It's about 3.5 years since you last fought now, since you retired. So,
yeah, time flies, yeah.
It does fly, it doesn't seem that long, does it, really, you think? But
I'd still whack on the gloves and take out most of them lightweights, I'm telling you.
Yeah.
Still not in bad nick.
Yeah. You'd still fight if you want for the eye, wouldn't you?
I'd definitely be fighting if you want for my eye. So, I've been here and there's a little ginger lad running his mouth anyway. I'll come back and give him a good hiding.
Yeah. That's
Joe. That Joe Murray, yeah, talking like he wants to have a fight.
I'll be.
I'll be his comeback
fight. Challenge champion, you mean?
Hey, the challenge champion, that's it.
What champion are you these days?
Bedroom champion.
You still do a bit, John. I'd still do a bit
of training to cover. Every now and again, it's good just to bluff some steam and that, and I like to whack the bags every now and again, and I've still got it, I'm not going to lie. Mm. I've still got it, man. I still go to town with someone.
You're getting there tomorrow, aren't you?
Yeah, enjoy it.
Does the training give you some kind of fulfillment, as, you know, obviously it's never going to replace you as a fighter, but, you know, bringing these lads through and putting your experience into them as well?
It's a different kind of buzz. I see lots of trainers out there, and they haven't got much experience. Their experience is the stuff what they do with the lads, but it's my experience level is a different class for what they've got. I can just look at a fight and read the fight in seconds, and it's just a different kind of experience what I've got. But it helps me out a lot. I can read fights and I know what to say to fighters. I know how to work with fighters in the corner. Mm. I don't get drawn into the old experience and start getting adrenaline rushes and all that. You know, I'm switched on. I know what to do. I know how to keep a fight calm, because I know I used to be able to keep myself calm backstage. As very, very good at it, very, very good mental attitude, and passing all my experience forward. You know, I enjoy it, and I'm good at doing it. I can relay messages very, very well. Sometimes it's not just about being a good trainer, it's about being a good speaker and being able to deal with people and relay your message the way you want it to and get it across easy enough for the fighter to understand. And I think I do that pretty well. And I'm happy with my two in life. I'm enjoying what I'm doing, and I'm good, man.
What fighters have you, obviously you've got your kid, Joe.
Yeah.
What other fighters in the gym are you working with?
But Jordan Latimer, she's Joe Gallagher's nephew. He had a good win on his debut. He looks really, really impressive. I've got Mikey Castell. He's making his debut in 2 weeks. He's not a bad little fighter. He's done MMA background, but fancy to go to boxing, and I've been working with him now for about six, 9 months. Changing his style, developing into a decent pro, and I've got Chris Conwell, who won the area title. He's had an English title shot against Townsend. He was doing really well in that fight, but just got caught with a shot. I know that Townsend's power, you know, he's known for being a bit of a puncher, but I really, after the first round, I thought, you know, it's going to be a night and that. He's walked onto one, what can you do? But he's got another title shot coming up in September. So we're working back towards that now and getting cracking, and that's it. We're building the gym slowly. I'm not one of them trainers where, you know, I'll go to all the shows and I'll pick up different fighters from here and there. I don't like doing that because I think it's snidey. You know, I've got my amateur team now, a lot of 10-year-old, 11-year-old boys, but getting them right stuck into it. They're here 3 times a week and we're working, we're developing them and that. And my idea is to get these kids through the amateurs. When he gets 18, 19, then turn them over. And then that's when my crop of good fighters will start coming through. So, you know, I'm planting the seeds and I'm watching them grow. And 10 years down the line, that's when my crop of good fighters are going to start coming through. You know what I mean? It's not about being one of them Jekyll, snidey people going to every show saying, oh, you want to come down to my gym, or oh, you could come down for a bit of pads and all that, which I could quite easily do, because obviously I've had a very, very successful career and I'm a very, very knowledgeable fighter. And you know, people used to watch me on TV all the time. They go, oh, that's John Murray, I'd love to go and train with him. You know, easy enough for me to do that, but that's just not the way I work. I'm not a snidey person like that, and I'm very, very straight and very, very down the line with people. And I like to act how I am. You know what I mean? I don't like to be Jekyll or snidey with everyone. So I'll get my crop of good fighters will come through in 10 years' time. So they'll come, and I'm pretty sure they will.
Job building. Oh, it's only been a short period of time.
Yeah, I'd say we've been here. Yeah, 2014, 3 years this now we've been here.
Champion, right here. Well, you're about good fighters.
I've been building them up since he was 10 years old. So
what happens, Joe? It used to be really quiet, didn't he?
Yeah, what happened to him? I don't know.
That fucked up the shit, champion.
He's got crap keeping our mouth shut, yeah. We got sick of it. But at the end of the day, boxing is one of them games. If you keep your mouth shut, you don't get nothing. I look back at my career a lot and I think about the way I used to be. And, you know, I used to let my fist do the talking. I wasn't really that gobby. And come to fight time, I was very respectful of my opponent. I'd always make an effort to shake his hand before the fight and I'd wish him luck. I said, good luck tomorrow, mate, blah, 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 and, you know, just the way it is, but, you know, in the end, boxing, it doesn't sell, and as much as everyone says, oh, he's a dickhead, or, you know, blah, blah, you've got to be a dick, I think, to make any real money out of the game. You did the interview with Kerry Kays where he said, I give more to boxing than what boxing gives to me. He's nothing, he couldn't be more, right? Because, like, say, being Mr. Nice Guy and being, you know, the gentleman or whatever, you don't work.
Well, Aaron Davies got stick.
You gotta be a dick.
Yesterday, on the interview on Taylor, for being nice, and he said, Baron McGuinn came out of a statement and said, look, you're not selling the fight, start being the dick. You gotta be the dick. And I'm the class A dick around here.
I think with you, John, you know, you didn't do all that trash talk. Your persona though was like this mean, moody, just getting there, don't want to speak to anyone. I think that, you know, for me as a fan of yours, I think that endeared me to you.
Because
you was this kind of, you know, character. You didn't quite work out.
A bit psycho.
You know what I mean? I like that.
Yeah,
and I think a lot of other people did.
It was a good persona too. I know what you mean.
You know, the way you come to the ring.
It wasn't put on or anything. That's just the way I am, isn't it?
Like he was in the zone a lot.
Yeah, I was just in the zone, yeah.
John, like on camera, he's not a dick, but in real life, he's a dick.
Well, that's it. You know, he was a bit of a joke, one of the lads and all.
Nail in the head, man.
But he was you know, you took
it's
boxing
mad because,
as
like,
it should have been
watched
it,
I've watched interviews of me in the past and that, and I looked at him, just sat there like that, eyes out, back of my head, and people asking me questions. I look like I'm going to jump up and chin the cameraman. And I said, mate, I spoke to him after, I said, mate, I've just watched an interview back, and you know what, honestly, I've no idea why I look like a psycho. I think it's my thinking face.
I'm
thinking from deep in thought, I'd have to look like an angry man. But,
you're scared of me once or twice.
In normal life, I'm quite a nice guy.
I keep with a good conversation,
So yourself, John, you know, you would probably still be boxing. A lot of people don't probably realise that what happened with your eye and, you know, some of the tough battles you had.
I'm practically blind in this eye. It's not so much about my bad eye, because my eye was getting worse and worse. Before the last fight, when I detached my retina, it was pretty bad. Before that Terry Mitchell fight, years earlier, the reason why I stopped wasn't because of this one, it was because of my good one. Because if this one went blind, and I can see where Joe is, I can see where you are, but I wouldn't have a clue who you was. I can just see a shape of where you are.
Just from that
I can just about see the mirrors and that, and the windows. I have no idea what numbers on the clock are out there, but this is my bad eye. I'm coping all right. It don't make a difference to my day-to-day life, but God forbid anything happens to my good eye, and that'll be it, won't it? I'll be a blind man, and then my whole life will be changed. So
you get a blue badge.
That's it. I get a blue badge, though, but I won't be driving anywhere, would I?
It's been a while, really. Then you fought with that.
Yeah, I had a bad eye for a bit. Yeah, years. Yeah. It started getting worse. But every time I get caught with a shot, my eyes go bright red. I start streaming like really bad. But you get caught into that thing, and you're like, you're so close to a world title. I remember I was undefeated for a lot of it, and it was like, one more fight. By the time I got beat off Mitchell, I'd literally given up on boxing. It was like, no matter how many fights I won, or how many times I kept winning, it was like, I knew I was never going to be a millionaire out of boxing. I'd do all right money-wise, but it'd be only enough to carry me for 6 months, and then I'd need another fight because the money would be getting low. So I knew I was never going to be a millionaire out of boxing, and by the time we got to that point, it was like, I just half give up. I just, you know, that's why, like,
You put fighters now, we find British fighters who are fighting at the top. They're earning more money than what John earned for his world title.
Yeah.
Do you know, John fought the best in Britain. You look at the time, McAllister was number two, and then Faxton was number two, and John boxed them all as the number twos. You see, if the number one fights number two now, they're earning stupid money, they're earning 100 grand each.
Yeah.
John never got that in his paydays.
I was just willing to fight anyone and everyone, and whoever they told me to fight, I never disputed it. I'd say no problem, I'm fighting. I never ducked a fight, I never said no to a fight. If they said you're fighting him, it was like, right, I'm fighting him. I never, that's the way it was, and that's the way a champion should be. I think that's what makes you people like you more, you know what I mean? If you see a fighter just picking his way, I think Amir Khan's a perfect example of someone who avoids fighters to pick his way up to the top of people that are better than him and that. And I think that's why people say, oh, well, you ducked him, but it makes them go off him a little bit sometimes, doesn't it? But if you see, if you're a champion, you fight whoever you're told. Yeah. Whoever the public wants to fight, and that's it. You should be. That's the way it should be.
I think that's why the fans endeared to you, John, because you was one of the fighters who'd get in there and fight anyone, and you know you didn't talk much, but you backed it up by just getting in the ring and doing your talking in the ring. You know, I mean that fight with Mitchell. I suppose at that time you didn't really have to take it.
I was above him. I didn't need the fight. The problem was with that fight was I was well up for the fight. I took the fight. And Joe Gallagher was adamant he didn't want to take the fight, but we had problems with Joe, trying to be my manager, and he kept cocking things up, and he'd keep me out of the ring for 6 months, and it was like, I had enough of it, so I brought in Mike Marsden to be my manager, and then Frank Warren said, we had a fight against that Uzagari, the fight before in London, yeah, one of the best performances, but he said, look, we need a better fight than that last time, because that last time he won the best performance, and he said, you got to fight Mitchell. My manager said, I've got to fight Mitchell. Joe Gallagher's like, we're not fighting Mitchell, blah, blah, blah. But I said, Joe, you're not my manager no more. Mike's my manager. I've got to do it with my manager. My promoter says, I've got to fight him. Manager says, I've got to fight him. You're my trainer. You train me to get me to beat him. Anyway, because I'd gone against him with that fight, practiced it there all the way up through the fight. We just didn't talk. It was when we were sparring, wasn't it, once?
You kicked off.
I stopped sparring mid-round, I turned around and went, oi! Joe said, you want to watch the fucking sparring? I've got a big fight coming up as well, you know, why don't you watch the sparring and tell him what I should and shouldn't be doing? But he wasn't interested, he had no interest in the fight, and then, obviously, we went off to Germany then, didn't we?
You did, how
out of Germany for the
fight. Fell out with me, because I signed a contract with the Atoms, even though they're by my promoters, and he kicked off with me and Anthony Crowler. We signed a contract and he said, you've done it behind my back. So I didn't go to Germany, I just fought. And Anthony Crowler went to Germany.
We went over to Germany and then Smacklin's World Title fight. It was like a couple of weeks before the Mitchell fight. And then we enjoyed a big massive bust up over there again. And I got beat anyway.
John, looking on you did eventually get a world title fight. It was against a prime Brandon Rios at the time. Even saying, sort of looking back on it, you know, I don't always like that question, what would you have done different, because it's in hindsight, but, you know, he didn't make the weight for that fight, he was up against that, he was obviously away from home, you'd had a long layoff as well, you'd had all that kind of training stuff, and then you went back to Joe for the fight. You know, looking back on it now, and when you do assess how it all went, and the result of the fight, you know, what do you think?
Are you on your way to school?
Yeah, I'm on the way.
Same bit. Sorry, I checked that.
No worries.
Looking back, you know, I was dead chuffed and dead happy with my performance. Looking back, I thought, you know, it was a real good, solid, strong performance. I still think it's one of the best performances of a British fighter away from home against a top class. I mean, he was the number one lightweight in the world. No one could dispute that. He was the best in the world. I went out there and I stood toe-to-toe with him, and he coming overweight. And I think on the day of the fight, it was something around. I was 10 stone 10, and he was close to 12 stone, and he was massive compared to me. I stood toe-to-toe in the pocket with him. I had it with him for 11 rounds, and in the end, I walked into a massive shot. But I didn't go down, I was still on my toe, and I was still standing there, toe-to-toe, having it out, one of the biggest punches in world boxing, number one lightweight in the world, away from home. And you know what? I couldn't be more proud of him, the effort, and after the performance, you've seen the state of my face. I mean, absolutely, look like I've been hit with a bus. Let me find that picture there.
That is, isn't it?
No, that's not the one. I went to the changing room after the fight and I was speaking to him. He said, I'll tell you what, John. He said, I'm not going to lie, that's the toughest fight of my career. He said, you're one of the hardest men I've ever been in the ring with. But that was me, right at my very best. Really, really fit, really, really strong. I honestly think, like, if he was a lightweight and he made the weight, yeah. And I made the weight and I was in there against the lightweight, I honestly think I would have won that fight. I think that was my night. There's my face after the world title fight. See you stay at that.
That's a bad one, I remember it.
You know what I mean? That was the next night, straight out on the rip with the lads in New York.
What you got?
That's okay, of course, did you? Johnny Bayata. So. Yeah, what? Good blackout, stop me going out on the rip.
I mean, you know, going into that fight with Rios, was you burning mentally?
Best I could be, physically and mentally. I was just absolutely unbelievable. And I knew it was my night. I just, like, even though he failed the weight, I didn't have to fight him because he failed the weight. I made the weight. We didn't have to take the fight, we could have gone into the fight. I mean, we made the weight, so we could have got paid full for the fight and not had the fight. And looking back, it probably would have been a smart move, you know, with the damage with the eye, because I think obviously that fight made my eye worse. But I was there to fight, I was there to win, and a couple of my mates have made the trip over from Manchester. So there's like 20, 30 of us over there, and I thought, you know what, I'm here to fight, man, and I fancied that would do him.
Yeah.
He was an inside fighter, very similar to me, and I'd never been beaten at my own game, toe-to-toe fighting inside the pocket and that, and I just fancied I would drag him down. He looked dead at the weight and I just thought, there's no way he's going to be able to go from that to winning the fight in 36 hours. And honest to God, I looked at him the next day in the corner and I went, whoa! Because he looked dead on the scales and...
like 2 stone there.
I looked at him across the ring and he looked like a middleweight. I was like, I don't get it, I didn't get it, but...
I remember that, like, I was there and, yeah. On the way, and I was like, John, I would fight this kid that I can't see how this fight's even, he's this good. And then when he was walking to the ring, oh my God, he looked huge. And then he started tapping the back. Glad you're fighting him.
Yeah, good, Johnny. Get in there, do you think?
Did you feel that, John? Could you feel his strength? His extra strength?
I didn't feel it.
Punch power, but his actual.
When
physical.
I watch it back, I can see, as we're going at it, but obviously a lot of the inside fighting is shoving and thinking. Obviously, I'm shoving someone that's like near enough a stone heavy than me. He's shoving me about. It's just easier if you're bigger, and it's obviously took more out of me. I've gotten 7 later rounds. I've walked into a big shot, but it was a good fight, and I couldn't be more proud of my performance. And you know, I love to scrap out, so yeah, it's a perfect kind of fight for me. But it's just the result wasn't the one I was hoping for. But I'd love to have done it again at some point. But was boxing is what it is, isn't it?
You mentioned there, you know, people talk about your losses, and I don't want to do it because I was there in these Wigan Park arenas and all these little small halls watching you at the beginning, and when you become British champion, European champion and all that, and there were some fantastic nights. I mean, these big fights you took, like with Mitchell, like I said, you didn't have to take that. The loss against Rios we've spoke about, and then the last fight was Crowler when you was probably, you know, he's gone on to prove, you know, himself. You was... at the stage where your eyes were like that, you'd been out of the ring for a while, you were, you know, it was just...
I've been out of the ring for the best fights,
for 2 years, so, you know, that's how you ended your career, but myself personally, and I know fans of yours, you know, won't look at it on them losses, we had some great nights.
Yeah, we had some top dudes, we did have some good dudes, and say me and my mates often get together, and we'll catch up.
After having 2 years out, and the time you did get that big fight, and one. Money on the line and a decent money in the Manchester arena, you probably wasn't the John Murray of a few years before.
Yeah, I think it just took me a bit too long to get there. You know, I look at other fighters and I think you have 20 odd fights and the next thing they're fighting British and the European. I thought about 27 fights, fighting for the world title. As me, it took me 23 fights and I had to have 4 defences of the British title before I got a European title, then I had to have 2-3 defences of a European, then I got intercontinental title shot, I lost to Mitchell, but then after I lost, I got a world title shot, you know, and that was always going to be with me. I was going to fight when I was undefeated and on the way up, and it was only when I got beat where the door started opening for me. But I just feel like my best days were behind me. I put a lot into them early fights, a lot of training, fight after fight after fight. I was busy, and it's hard, man, you're grueling on the body, and but like I say, I'm dead proud of myself and dead proud of the career that I had. I couldn't be more happy with it.
Yeah. You're probably right. There's a lot of people who'll win a British title, might not win it outright like you did, and if they do win a European, they maybe not defend that. They're just looking to go straight on to internationals and world titles. So you did have it, do it the hard way.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. English, British, European.
You did it the right way.
WBC.
Old-fashioned good way.
Yeah. I just wanted that world title, man. I was desperate to add it to a collection. I knew I was never going to finish boxing with pots of money or anything like that, but I wanted just the series of belts, man. And that would have been me, and I've been happy that whatever I did. But like I say, the proudest achievement is finishing boxing, because all the way through my career, I always panicked. Even from being like 21, 22, I knew you're never going to last forever. I thought, what am I going to do when boxing finishes? Because, you know, my other mates, he's all going uni or whatever, blah, 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 and he's all getting jobs. I watched them all progress, like from 18, 19, I was going, you know, I was out with him and that, and he was going through uni. Then they all got the jobs at like 21, 22, and I was still boxing, but I knew I'm going to last forever. And it worried me for a long time what I was going to do after boxing. And I was lucky enough to, when I had that 2-year break, I failed the brain scan, didn't I? I had a year out of the ring after the Rios fight, and then I tried to fight Gavin Reese in December, and a week before the fight I got the news that I'd failed the brain scan. It kept me out of the ring for another year. But I think it was a blessing in disguise, because that 2-year break gave me an opportunity to learn and value money and be skinned and have to go and get a job and stuff like that. And you look at your blessings, and that was a big, big blessing for me. And then, lucky enough, I got the opportunity to be able to get my license back. And
got John Simpson.
Simpson fight. I can't remember his name. The Spanish kid. Yeah, yeah.
Jungle Book kid.
Yeah, yeah. And then I had the John Simpson fight, and then I had the Crawler fight. But by this point, I knew it was nearly over, and I had respect for money, so I had the money for the Crawler fight. Even though I didn't know it was going to be my last fight, I'd sunk it into my gym. I'd put a bit of money away, and I'd got this place set up. And looking for me, that happened after the 2-year gap, because I would have finished my career, and then I blew all my dough, and there would be no second chances. So that brain scan really turned out to be a blessing in disguise for me. And Escobar, that's the one, yeah. Pablo. So there we go, yeah, man. It's all worked out well. I'm happy, man. I'm really dead happy and dead good place. Mm-hmm. I'm good.
It's all written, it's meant to be. You'll produce a world champion, eh?
Yeah, I know where I'm up to, and 10 years from now my lads come through the system of the John Murray conveyor belt, and that's when I start producing real good pros. Mm. Joe's flying the flag for us at the minute. I've had him since he was born, Anna. Mm. 2 years old, I would have been when he was born. I got him out and started doing his press ups, and that's it. So
you're not still not sharp with each other with cushions on your hands and that, do you?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Slap boxing, blah blah blah.
I think that's all we need, is the opportunity. We get the opportunity as Jim prevails. You know, like, look at Chris Conwell. He wasn't supposed to win the Southern Area Temple against Lee Appleyard, when I knocked him out. I went to Denmark, knocked the kid out. You know, when it stacked against us, we always see him come and do the goods. Yeah. So Crawler picked the phone up, getting knocked out.
John, you know, I can speak for myself, and I'm sure I speak on behalf of a lot of British boxing fans. You was one of the great fighters to watch from this country, and you know, you brought a lot of pleasure to a lot of fans, and always wore your heart on your sleeve, and always give it your all. And I'm sure everyone remembers.
There was no quitting, like, me, was the man? You know what I mean? Even when I got beat, I didn't go down and stay down. I always got up again, and I'm always still trying to fight back. And so I always got stuck to my feet, didn't I? But
that's it. It was one of you, like the ring walk as well. You know, Johnny B. Good come on, and everyone was buzzing, and it was great. The crowds, the you know, your mates who came along, and the noise they made. And
it was tough, wasn't it? I enjoyed it. It was good, man. So I remember the first time I come out to a big fight, and I heard the noise. It was the first time I talked to Bill, and oh god, the hairs on the back of my neck stood up. I started trying to sprint to the ring because my adrenaline was going that bad. But it's good, man. I've got loads of good memories from boxing. And it was good, man.
You give a lot of good memories as well, mate.
Yeah, nice one, mate. Top man.
Brilliant to see you. All the best. God bless you with what you're doing and everything. And
thanks a lot.
We'll catch up again.
Appreciate that, mate. Top man.